Good evening. Today is October 15th. Welcome to the school committee meeting. We'll open this meeting with public comment. Does anybody have a comment?
Call to order.
And I'm sorry, call to order. Ms. Gui?
Present.
Ms. Markey?
Yeah, present.
Ms. Scoville is
Not
here. She'll be coming shortly, I understand. Mr. Broskall?
I am here.
And I am here. John, the first item is the capital budget?
No, personnel report.
Oh, I'm sorry, personnel report.
So we have one item to ask you to vote on. This is a proposed out-of-state overnight field trip to Sicily and Greece in February 11th through February 20th, 2021. The trip combines culinary arts and the business department and members of the English department for a field trip to Sicily and Italy for the purpose of cultural exploration, understanding our global connections, and learning some of the historical roots of Latin and Greek language. Trip dates will be 2011 to 2021. My understanding is that the 2011, which is a Thursday, is at the end of the day, but that they would miss Friday. And I don't know whether that is necessary to secure this trip or not. So certainly I'd be happy to get that information. The cost to each student is $4,082, and there's no cost to the students.
Any questions?
No, because I remember they did the presentation last spring. Frankly, I wish I could go. It was wonderful. Thank you.
My only question is, when they do miss school, do we know how the material is made up?
They're required to get it ahead of time,
yeah.
And they are required to make it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Broskall, no questions? And I have no questions. Do I hear motion to approve an out-of-state field trip for Bedford High School students to Sicily and Greece from February 11th to February 20th, 2021, at a cost of $4,082 with early registration, $4,282 after October 30th, that's correct?
Correct.
2019, to the students and no cost to the schools?
So moved.
Mr. Broskall moves.
Second.
Ms. Markey seconds. All who approve say aye.
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 Aye. All who oppose say no. Okay, so that is approved 4-0-0, because Sarah is not here yet.
Okay.
Thank you.
We do have a number of stipended positions, but those will be submitted for the record tomorrow. We don't need to review them. And the next thing before we get on to the full substance of the meeting is to ask your approval for an in-kind material donation to the schools. I'm really excited to share that Don Kirsch, who's a Bedford resident, is offering to provide our students with the opportunity to apply their science skills and to strengthen their investigations with the donation of a Mettler Toledo AG104 analytical balance, which is in excellent condition, estimated value $1,635. And a Zeiss STEMI 2000 dissecting microscope, also in excellent condition, with Foster ACE fiber optic illumination, estimated value $5,750, for a total estimated value for your approval of $7,385.
Any questions?
No question, but an observation. I think it would be outstanding to write this up somewhere, because there may be other folks in town that would do this, given our makeup, and don't even realize that it's an option.
Great idea.
We may have someone in the audience who
Might
handle that kind
that.
Of responsibility.
Here's a thought.
We can get some pictures, I bet.
That's so wonderful that he thought of us. It's incredibly generous.
I have no questions. Wonderful.
Thank you, Mr. Kirsch.
Okay. I also am very grateful to Mr. Kirsch for his generosity. I do have a question, and that is whether the donation will require any sort of ongoing maintenance expense, or if this is something that the school would replace in the future when it becomes obsolete for our purposes.
I will find that out.
Okay.
I don't know the answer to this question.
Okay.
I don't think we would plan to replace them.
Okay.
But let me inquire.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Do I hear a motion to accept a donation of a Mettler Toledo AG14 analytical balance in excellent condition with an estimated value of $1,635 and a Zeiss STEMI 2000 dissecting microscope in excellent condition with Foster ACE fiber optic illumination in excellent condition at an estimated value of $5,750 for a total of $7,385?
So moved.
Ms. Markey moves.
I'll second.
And Ms. Guay seconds. Thank you, Ms. Guay. And thank you again to Mr. Kirsch for his generous donation. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed say no. And no abstention. So that's approved 400. Thank you. So the next item is capital budget.
So this is being presented by Tasir Alani, our Director of Facilities, and Julie Corain, our Finance Director.
Thank you.
Nice photos.
Well, I've joined Tasir for the first time this year in the internal capital group, which is all the department heads and the town administration. And it's been a great process to refine the information to be provided to CapEx, which you're going to get a preview of this evening, and also to really beef up the backup materials that are distributed. And so hopefully you noticed that those were a little more in detail. And you know, next steps, we're in great shape at this stage, and we're preparing for the CapEx meetings, both town facilities. Tasir is the busy department. The facilities department has many, many projects, of course, and we will be November 13th and November 20th before CapEx. Okay, you want to do your animation?
Sure. So we thought we would run really some of the projects we did just last year before we get you into the FY21. So this is the high school gym area. This is the expansion between the old and the new addition. It kind of settled, and so we addressed it, we grind it, and then we added the plate. We painted the flag outside the high school. We redid the gym completely, the gym floor at JGMS and the high school. We did a lot of interior painting, thanks to your support. Every year it's an annual thing that we do. And we did, when we were doing the Davis project, we took really advantage of the opportunity and redid the dishwasher. You would think just buying a dishwasher is a small project. It turned out to be a huge one because the new regulations require a grease trap, and it required the new electric service and everything else. So, but at the end, this is the dishwasher. It's a good size dishwasher where they just insert like a good tray and they steam it and wash it. And so we did that. We did Davis and actually Town Center completely 100% LED lights with the Green Community Grant. So that was no cost to us. We started JGMS. We're making good progress, so we're on time. And this is the high school progress. The high school is way ahead of schedule. Certainly by Christmas, they could be there. but we're making progress. We painted lane, the exterior painting. We added the security cameras at lane and the high school. This is all exterior cameras. And we also built the vestibule for lane. That was, lane was the only school that did not really have a double entry. And now it's like Davis. The first one is open. The second one, you would have to get buzzed in with a phone camera thing installed. We also added the solar. And we added the tray for the liquid to remove. And the biggest prize was obviously Davis. So that was the highlight of just 1 year. So the review for the 2022-2026, obviously we just made the statement here. It will change. It will change really a lot. Any HVAC, any project that has any form of efficiency will be developed into our 10-year energy plan. Our 10-year energy plan will be built around the 6-year capital plan. And we'll give you some examples as to what, do you have the spreadsheet?
They have it in their backup material.
Okay. So I think we may have highlighted some of what's on the spreadsheet. For example, in like 2023, 24, 25, we're going to redo the boilers at the high school. And instead of doing just one for one, we're going to take the 1 point something million and just develop the, so address the whole high school in terms of the town's approach to net zero and energy efficiency as we move away from fossil fuel. So instead of really just replacing one boiler for one boiler, we're looking at different options so we can address the town's and achieve the town's goal for net zero. And close to net zero, but be more dependent on renewables. So that's what you have in the spreadsheet, the 22 to 26. So I can give you an example. Actually, we highlighted the public library. We were going to just really replace two pieces of equipment for HVAC for about 1 point something million. And when we did the study, the feasibility study, we came back with the design to change the design so that we do achieve close to net zero. And if it's not really achieving a net zero, but we do depend more on electrical than fossil fuel. So that's the whole idea behind the new policy by the town. And it's the result of the net zero study that was done last year. So for 2021, these are the capital projects that we're proposing. Because there's not really much of building projects, now we're focusing on other things. So we waited, we had held off on the commissioning or recommissioning, retro commissioning of Davis until the project was over. When the project is over a building, then we go back and recommission, retro-commission the whole building together, the new addition as well as the existing addition. So this is the equipment, the HVAC equipment that we would fine-tune, and it's basically, we put it back to its original, really, conditions as if it just came out of the factory. So that's a retro commissioning. We're required to provide a Gantt chart or a time frame for every project we do now from start to end. This is just an example. I think we only gave you one just to show you. Some projects take longer than others because of procurement, because of engineering. So it depends, but this is just an idea as to what it takes for advertisement by the time, you know, annual town meeting approves it, we select an engineer, we sign a contract, we do building inventory, testing, repairs, and go through the whole process. But this gives the town an idea as to how long it would take for each project to do. The flooring scrubber, this we switched, instead of behind the wheel you push, now this is the one that you stand on, and it's much more efficient for almost the same money. The engine is more efficient, but it's faster, and it really saves us in the summer on overtime, because you can do a good size area with this machine. So our goal, as you know, a piece of equipment, this one is like the furniture you only get when you build a new school. So we never really used to replace the equipment, just like furniture. You only get them when you build the school. So we started to do one machine per year. So that's last year we bought one for Lane. The flooring, it's been a great really investment for us. And we're addressing areas where we see the most needed. And this one, as you might know from the past, we developed it based on a 15-year cycle, so that hopefully every 15 year you go back to where you started. The PA system, we had some money funded last year to do the gym like we did Davis and Lane. And then we found out from the principal that there were some weak areas in the at one end of the school where when they did the ALICE training, they really couldn't hear in the classroom. So we decided to just readdress the entire PA system at the school. The picture on the left is really the old electronics that you see. The one on the right, that we would have a solid PA system. And right now, even the PA is tied into the bell system. It takes manual use. The staff at the front desk, they would have to change it almost weekly and put the new schedule. If you have a delay, if you have something, it throws the whole schedule off. The new system, it's so automated, you don't really, it's once a year and that's it. Even if there is a delay, it will adjust itself. It will adjust the time on it. So it's a great, and this is even 4 years ago from the previous principal asked me really to look into it. That's how old this system was. When the high school went through the renovation, most of the equipment wasn't really renovated, wasn't replaced. Whether it's the mechanical, the boiler, the PA, those were really kind of, did not get renewed. Painting, as you know, is a very efficient way of doing in-house painting, because we do it when we do the cleaning of the classrooms versus having a contractor, because there's so much downtime. We clean it, we take everything out, we paint it, we put things back. So it's a very efficient and really least expensive way to do in-house painting for classrooms. The program space mod, this is the one that we started a few years ago at 50 cents per square foot. So we were at 300,000 to do space mod. We're now down to the 40,000. And I think one more year will probably, next year we'll cut that in half, because it will be just occasional things that the principals may need, and they would only know when they need it late in June or May or June at the end of the year. But as we renovated all the schools and we're doing these building projects, we'll really need less of the space program modifications. But it would be good to have some in case there is something the principals need to do. And that's it.
So the school projects are in two categories, and a much busier category is the individual school capital projects that we've just been through. So really the only one in that category is the third phase of the high school auditorium. And with much teamwork across facilities in the schools, we did award. Phase two is underway this month and should be finished for the town meeting. So that the
special
town meeting.
That would be great.
Yeah, it should be already.
That was our goal all along. It's just a lot of moving parts. So that's a single request in that category. And then the others are really the asset-based replacement plans that we've been proposing for the last number of years, including the school IT replacement and the school photocopiers. And we have added, really from Tessier's recommendation, that we really work on including durable furniture and equipment, and as he has done for, say, floor scrubbers, some of the heavy, expensive custodial equipment that really does wear out and need to be replaced. And so this, we are proposing to build in a similar type of arrangement for our more durable furniture and equipment. So it is not a matter of doing as much as we can within a limited construction budget for furniture, fixtures, and equipment, or also with sort of any year-end savings that might materialize. So this will allow for some better planning, more predictability. So we're hoping to propose that. So just a little bit more information about the theater video project. Should be terrific, and will be similar to what we've done in the other schools.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we have finished the full inventory that had been requested, and you all have a summary in your packet. And we were also trying to delineate and clarify sort of three major categories of items that are important for instructional technology: desktops, laptops, Chromebooks, and then the instructional technology, the smarts, and the document cameras, and those types of things. And then the infrastructure. And typically we start those projects as soon as the funding is available and, you know, are able to implement the replacements within 6 months. The infrastructure project timing does really vary. And just some statistics: about half of the funding over the 6 years of the request is in the technology infrastructure category, and about half is in the instructional realm. And again, you have the inventory, and you have a detail on the FY21 items that are coming up for replacement based on lifetimes. And our IT department does evaluate. Maybe a lightly used device can go another year. So it's at the end, there's an evaluation of the assets before a final determination is made. And again, just as a reminder, we know that the iPads are leased within our operating budget. And that's just some more details about the 21 request, which we have delineated, but it sort of boils down to those types of numbers that are due for replacement in each of our schools and grade levels. And this is the, again, the durable school furniture and equipment. To outfit a brand new empty school building, the furniture and technology is really about $1 million proposition based on the similar type sizes of enrollment, 500 to 600 students. So we're really asking for really just a very small piece to be able to keep equipment such as weight rooms that was recently refurbished, and also classrooms that really need broken things. And I think a lot of stuff is in terrific condition, but there are some things that need to be replaced.
So for Davis, we averaged about $20,000 per classroom for the new classrooms for furniture. So it can be, that's why it's hard to really do it on the operating budget. You need to come up with, like Julie said, you need to start facing them, you know, in capital. 10 classrooms at Davis, $200,000 between the smart board, the furniture, the chairs, the table. So they can be expensive. And then you have the cafeteria that has furniture and other areas.
Yeah. And just starting incrementally, kind of looking at a percentage, what percentage of durable furniture and equipment could be replaced. Equipment, we have less big equipment that's in expensive equipment. I'm thinking mostly weight rooms and soccer goals and things like that that so you could sort of replace a little bit more on a percentage basis. And we have, these are the top requests from the principal that are delineated and also in a handout. And again, the photocopiers. We, you know, have an inventory, which you have a copy of, and we know when generally keeping them in working order. We like about 3 years. Sometimes they can go a little bit longer. And that's something we've been doing with capital funds very gratefully for several years. So I think that's about it. When do you want the parking? Do you want to go into the these slides?
Sure. Oh, good. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
So this is the JGMS front parking. We met with the planning and conservation, and there was some opposition as to the number of trees we were taking. Again, I just want to emphasize, though, this project came from us. It was really never requested by anyone but our department, myself, because I myself witnessed 2 car accidents, and there is no statistics as to how many were missed, because, you know, it may be happening every day. So we wanted to really enhance the safety and at the same time, you know, enhance the area. The safety was to build an island and create a one way in, one way out, so you can see the island up where the white car, way up the top. So that's Railroad Ave when it changes into McMahon and you take a right. So we went from initially proposing 24 trees to now 10. And there is one, oops.
I just took 2 of the slides.
Oh, okay. There was actually one that would show you. We're not really, overall for the project,
right.
we're at even number because we're adding a lot of trees on the wing where we're adding the 2 additions. So overall for the project, it's 0. Just this area, we're only removing 10 trees. And so we just wanted to update you on it. We're going to meet again with the town side and, you know, the BARC committee, the planning, the whoever really has a say in it, and present it one more time and go from there. So we just wanted to update you on it. Again, it's a safety issue to us, where that at the top, that's the island that we would be building. So this is really a rendering. It doesn't change much. People were concerned about changing the island looking or something looking. It doesn't really change much other than create a safe way for our staff to park in and out, and then you know, the island really we're building so that it's a controlled traffic and it's a safe way. But you do have to get some trees out of the way, and we would plant really trees. It's not, we're planting more trees now. So we just wanted to update you. Thank you.
Any questions?
Just a couple. First of all, this is very thorough, thank you. And not really my wheelhouse, so it was really interesting to go through it. And I like all the pictures and everything. I felt really well informed. With respect to the forest service, do the staff like them?
Yeah, they really do. So something like this, we really, the end users, we send them out to other schools to try them.
Okay.
So we sent a couple of custodians to a couple of schools. One of them was up in New Hampshire. They wanted to try them. Mm-hmm. Just like the flooring, when we started doing the new floor, we went out to various places. We talked to facilities managers. But in this case, yes, we really put the custodians in touch with custodians, talk and see if you like them.
And they must have been thrilled to be asked.
Yes. Oh, absolutely, because they're the users.
They're there, that's right. No, yeah. I think it's fantastic. And then, with the, I'm so excited about the audio system being ready for town meeting. That can only help us as we go through that every year. And Julie, as you did the school IT replacement and the various categories, was there anything that surprised you as you put it all together, other than it's a pretty big task to try to figure out what everybody has all the time?
No. I thought it was our IT department completed that inventory and summarized it, and I think that they've done a terrific job.
Good. So nothing jumped out. And then, very helpful with respect to the furniture. This is sort of a silly question. With respect to all the copiers on the back. So we buy lots of different copiers. Obviously, we have Riso machines. Those are the Mimeo machines. And then we have the Toshibas and the Konicas and the... Is there any reason why we don't buy all the same, or do schools have different needs, different picks, or, like, can we get a better rate if we agree to buy all Toshiba copiers, or it doesn't work that way?
So, sorry. Usually, we have been loyal to certain copiers and then decided that the service wasn't there, or the cost was high.
Oh, because it's the service that drives it, not
exactly.
Just the machine.
Exactly, yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So that is something that, you know, develops, and we try to make the best decision on cost and service and reliability, and
the
end users, which ones.
It's more service than,
yeah.
I mean, the machines matter, but it's really the service. If the light's on, it doesn't work. I didn't think about that.
And again, the end users, the teachers have to like them too.
Good.
We do try to mix in some of the higher volume, lower cost machines.
And then I just want to say kudos for the parking lot on JGMS. As someone who drives by there about 30 times a day, especially in the, it's one thing the staff are used to it, but it's when the parents go in or other people are, and they don't know it, or families from other towns that are parking there for sporting events. Mm. It really is a tricky spot.
Mm.
So I just want to applaud you for doing that. Frankly, I wish we'd thought of it, but that's a great addition, so thank you. That's all.
I just had a question about the intercom system for the high school. I think it's high school. Is that in limbo, or is that happening, or the replacement of it?
So that's the project now. So we're proposing, no, it works now, right? The existing?
Yeah.
So, no, the existing one works right now.
Okay.
It's just, it's really old, and there's some classrooms where they don't receive the announcement as good as other ones. So even prior to really proposing this one, we did some tweaking. We had a company come in and do some technical troubleshooting to it.
Right.
It's an old, old system. It goes back to really way before the renovation, you know, from the 80s.
So it's being replaced?
Correct.
Yes. Okay. And it sounds like it was on hold, but it's not any longer?
No. Right? So I'm sorry. Yes. Now I know the
maybe
question.
Maybe I'm confused. Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry. I wasn't clear
so
at the beginning.
So for, say, Davis and Lane, we did a brand new kind of a PA and training and a video, just like this one, actually, for the principals, for teachers, for training, for showing the kids. So the plan was for every gym where it's a big area, we would do a video system with the PA system in the gym area. So the high school was next.
Okay.
So when we were talking about this project this past summer with John and staff, we were made aware that during the ALICE training, some classrooms didn't really hear any of the announcements. So John asked us to hold off on that part and just do the entire school. So the gym will be done, but it will be part of the whole PA system in the school.
Okay.
So we, instead of spending money now, the one we had, 60-something thousand, on a project, and then go do it again, we just decided to get one full system, one big system for the whole school.
Okay. And we have the date on when that's happening?
So if this one now is approved in March,
yep,
we can start really by the end of the summer, we could have it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. And then just a general question about the timelines on replacing, like, copiers and furniture and all that. How do you get those figures? Like, where does that come from? How do you determine that a copier is 6 years and something else is 15 years? Or
Industry standards and experience.
Yeah.
And then, you know, of course, looking at, like, service calls and, yeah.
And then it just gets calculated out on a sort of year-by-year basis on how many need to be done at any given time?
That's right, yeah. Okay. It's very specific, especially with the IT inventory and the copier inventory, based on their purchase dates, how long they've been used, their scheduled replacement date, and again, that of final evaluation, like, are we really ready to replace this thing, or can we get another 6 months, a year out of it?
Thank you.
Hi. Sorry I'm late. I'm going to pass it over.
I love the organization of the requests and categories. The replacement schedules have been asked for by Capital. They'll be very happy to see them. The roofs are all on the six-year plan for 2026. You had talked about moving them up. Might those be moved up between now and your presentation to Capital, or will that be a conversation for later in the year?
I think the town would rather wait.
Okay.
Yeah.
On page 16, I loved the graphic, which I'll point out to you, about the percentage of the requests that were, 60% hardware classroom, 34% hardware student staff devices, 50% infrastructure. Is that where we want to be? Is that like an accepted ratio of annual replacement and how those break down? Should we strive to be again, right there on an annual basis, or will that shift a little bit each year? Yeah.
So let me see. This is a replacement, an asset replacement plan. So are there new things that sometimes we want to add?
Yep.
That's a separate category.
Right.
And if you look at the six-year plan, which you have on the GFAO sheets, the detailed page, the one-pagers, you'll see it's pretty uneven. That's based because this is over a six-year span that it's a kind of a 50-50.
Sure.
But if you look at an individual year, it's not like that at all. For example, FY21 is all student devices, all in classroom stuff.
Okay.
So that's not really an answer, but that's kind of how the planning works for the replacement.
Mm-hmm. I also was interested about the inventory. It's great to have the district-wide numbers. I love how the replacement is right below it, which is also wonderful. And I think this question has been asked to us by others in the past about the ratios of devices, you know, per child. We're not striving for one-for-one, yet we seem to be adding, perhaps, devices. I'd be curious at some point to look at just the trend of devices to kid over the years, and is that gap kind of staying consistent, or is it getting kind of closer together? Are we approaching just a de facto, every kid's having access to one? I know there's one-to-one at the high school with the iPads, but I'm just curious about the trends of devices per kids. I'm also curious about the Chromebook to iPad ratios. We've been wondering for a while about the usage. In some schools, it's really close. Like at JJMS, there's 240 Chromebooks and 332 iPads. And other schools, there's more of a gap. So I'm still just wondering out loud about that usage and what we're using for. And will we be trending up and getting more Chromebooks at the same ratio as iPads? Not really a question, just a wondering. Mm-hmm. Do with that what you will. And I'll just second the Railroad Avenue parking lot comment. It is always a disaster waiting to happen. I would just hope that along the new parking lot and the island, we just step up some enforcement of the stop sign. And maybe there's a way to calm that curve in some sense with DPW and make people just actually stop.
The police are pretty good.
Very dangerous for kids. So thank you for all that. But great detail. Thank you, and appreciate it.
Thank you. It was an excellent presentation. I do have a few questions, which I need to put my glasses on to read. I was also at that last Arbor Resources Committee meeting, and I was just wondering, there were issues other than the strict number of trees that were raised, and does this plan address some of those, that not increasing parking, keeping the the scrub brush that provides cover mm-hmm. for, so that's,
yes.
you've addressed that? Okay,
yes.
Super, thank you. Is there a need to increase the interior painting and flooring cycles to reflect that there's a slightly larger space at two of the schools and much larger space at Davis?
Meaning?
So you have more square footage. Are you, I couldn't tell whether the increase was strictly inflation or are you factoring in that there's more space to be painted and floored?
Yeah, no, that's from VFA. So every April, the program was carrying about 2 to 5% inflation adjusted.
Okay.
So it adjusts by itself. I think I still would feel comfortable between 40 to 50,000. That's really how much we can handle because it's during the time that we can do those things.
Okay.
And that's how we based our also really to match it with the 15-year. The painting is about 7 years, so that every room will have to be repainted, give or take, every 7 years. The flooring every 15.
Okay. I noticed that I think in 2026 there was some money for security systems. Is that replacement of existing systems? Does that add some new features that maybe we should think about moving closer?
I'll have to look at it, which one. Is it system-wide, does it say?
No, it was, I'm sorry, I don't know if I flagged it here.
So?
Oh, wait, here, let's see. It's a, oh, I'm sorry, that's roof replacement. There's a security system, card access system replacement at the high school and intrusion detection system schools.
Yeah, so that's, again, we base it on the life expectancy, and then we reassess every time, you know, we get closer to it. So that's all the card readers and the intrusion system, which is the monitoring of the glass. And so we know they last about 10 years. So we put it on VFA, and as we get 7, 8 years, we start really reevaluating and shifting if we need to.
All right, so it's just replacement
Correct.
Of existing equipment.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Julie, the inventory for IT is great. And like Dan, as a CapEx member, I think that they'll really appreciate the detail. I was wondering if all of the equipment in there is replacement of existing equipment, or is there an addition of equipment?
So I think what it is what I've been, what's been described, and John, you know, maybe you should answer this one, but it's not a lockstep. For example, if a teacher laptop is due for replacement and a product, the products change, it's not, you know, they're going to get the best product. And there was some shifting between instead of adding Chromebooks, instead of iPads, you know, things change very rapidly, obviously, in this sector. And they take all that into account. It's based on the replacement, but they make the smartest decision that they can make in the moment based on what the kids, what the students need, what's needed for teaching and learning, and what the best options are.
So, in addition, these do not include expansions, right? We have in the past because we had to fully outfit. And certainly, we can't predict at this point that there won't be a need for some kinds of expansion as technology changes. But right now, this is replacement, taking into account, you know, changes in the nature of the products.
Okay.
And the quality of the products.
Okay. That's good to know. All right. Thank you very much. I have no other questions. So do we need to, this is for information only at this point?
This is for information only at this point.
Okay.
I think we'll bring some figures only back the next time and ask you to vote to approve putting them forward.
Yeah. Yeah, historically you would vote next time, but we'll give you the cost of the project because that's what will be printed.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can vote on it.
Okay, super. Thank you. Anything else on this item?
No, thank you.
Okay, so we're actually going to flip the next two items. We're going to do the school committee roles.
You.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you very much, Tasir, and thank you, Julie.
That was really helpful.
So, and then we'll do the class size report afterwards. So we're going to assign the school committee roles. We're going to elect a chair, vice chair, and secretary for the coming year. Do I hear a nomination for a chair?
I
Or, I'm sorry, does anybody have any questions or thoughts about this before we start the process?
I'm excited.
Okay. All right.
No questions.
Do I hear a nomination for a chair?
You. So someone has to formally nominate.
I nominate Joanne Santiago as the chair of the school committee.
Okay. Thank you for your confidence. Do I hear a second?
I second.
Thank you. Any other nominations for chair? Okay. So this requires a majority roll call vote. Ms. Guay?
Yes.
Ms. Markey?
Yes.
Ms. Scoville?
Yes.
Mr. Roskell?
Yes.
Okay, and I'm a yes. Thank you for confidence. So we also need to have a nomination for vice chair. Ms. Scoville, will you be vice chair?
Sure.
Okay.
I'm happy to.
I'm sorry, can I do that? I don't know if I can.
Joanne,
Ms. Scoville, would you like?
Sure.
Okay, so Ms. Markey nominates. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, Ms. Guay seconds. Any other nominations for vice chair? Okay. A vote to elect Ms. Scoville vice chair. Ms. Guay?
Yes.
Ms. Markey?
Yes.
Ms. Scoville?
Yes.
Mr. Roskell?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. And now we need to nominate a secretary. Do I hear a nomination for secretary?
I nominate Joe Markey.
I second it.
Okay. Do I hear any other nominations? Okay. Not hearing any other nominations. So we'll take a vote to elect Ms. Markey, school committee secretary. Ms. Guay?
Yes.
Ms. Markey?
Yes.
Ms. Scoville?
Yes.
Mr. Roskell?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. All right. Thank you very much and congratulations.
Thank you.
Class size report?
Yes.
Okay, so the next item is the class size report presented by Mr. Sills.
So this is our annual class size report pursuant to the October 1st calculations and assessment of our numbers, which is what we submit to the state. And we use this for a number of reasons, but certainly as we build the budget, it's an important reference. So just in terms of enrollment trends, our preschool since 2012 has stayed pretty steady, but it has taken a significant jump this year to 51 with four new, wonderfully sized classrooms at the Davis School. It's good timing. Davis School, we're at 598. Up from 492 in 2012. Significant jump. Lane, 537, now it's 601. JGMS, 577, it dipped down to 503, 530, and it's been steadily climbing. It's at 594 this year. We had a bumper year in 2012 at the high school. And it was reflected during a couple of those years, dipped, and it's climbing steadily back. And you'll see what the trends are intended to be or expected to be. So our total this year has grown from 2487 in 2012 to 2634, and inclusive of the preschool, from 2527 to 2685. Now, those numbers in some places are exactly what the NSDEC projections were. So the high school, again, or 842 was projected, we're 841. The middle school, 634, and we are at $1,920, $595, and we are close to that at $594. The differences are that our Lane School and our Davis School are a little lower, so $598 is what we are presently in $601, and we were projected to be $612 at Davis and $633 at Lane. These were our own calculations, not based on NESDEC, but looking at the trends based on Space Needs Task Force and the enrollment study, and then projecting out from there, taking into account move-ins as well as birth rates, et cetera. And again, it's like the NESDEC, it's a little higher than what it's panning out to be. But if you look at the figure that we projected, 5711, and that's the total pre-K through 12, and we are at 2685. So 2685 from 2711 is about 26 student difference in the aggregate. So our class size guidelines that the school committee voted on as guidelines 3 or 4 years ago. Kindergarten, we aim to be 18, but our max is 20. Grade 1, 20, max of 22. Grades 2 through 5, ideally 22, with a max of 24. 6 through 8, 23, with a max of 25. And then, as you know, the high school, our college prep courses, we aim to hold at 18, but we can go up to 20. And our honors, high honors, and AP classes, 22. But again, we're ready to go up to 25 when we need to. So Davis School, this is the breakdown. So you've seen the total numbers. But what we have at Davis School is kindergarten, 183 students. First grade, 198 students, and second grade, 217 students. So there's a little skewing between kindergarten and second grade. There will be a challenge when 217 kids go to third grade, because presently we have 10 second grade classrooms, but third grade we only have 9. So those numbers will push our limits, and we're going to have to look at that closely. In the notes you see which are the integrated classrooms, which are co-taught classrooms, where our sales students are included, and of course the complexity of our classrooms is significant, as well as the aggregate, the total number. Integrated preschool, we have 23 special education students, 28 non-special education students, and 4 students who receive services outside of the preschool, either in their homes or in the district. Lane School, third grade presently is 194, so you'll see that's a big jump from 194 to what could be 217 next year, if there's no attrition. 199 for fourth grade, so there won't be a big difference there where we could kind of grab a teacher. In fifth grade, 208, again, too incremental a difference to make a change in terms of the number of classroom teachers. So again, that's going to be a pressure point next year. All three grades at Lane School have 9 students, and you see the SAIL students. I think these are our SAIL intensive students who are served primarily. No, there's a combination of our SAIL intensive students and our SAIL moderate needs students who are fully integrated into the
excuse
classroom.
Excuse me, John, we have no female students in the SAIL program?
Not at this point, at Lane. No. J. JGMS enrollment, 202 in sixth grade, 210 in seventh grade, 182 in eighth grade. So again, when our approximately 208 kids from fifth grade move to JGMS next year, will be 1826 more students. Pardon?
Well, I'm just muttering along with you.
Yeah, about 26 more students. And JGMS will continue to grow. We do keep track of the comings and goings at JGMS. So this year, these are the students who transferred into JGMS. We have some private school, many public schools, some out of state, and continues here, a couple new Metco students as well. So we have more students coming into JGMS this year than departing. Mm-hmm. In terms of the departing, most of them are moves, but we do see one, the private school, yes, darn little dot. Private school 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Eight private school transfers. These are our core class size averages at JGMS. In sixth grade, 19.55%, 19.55 students. Seventh grade core average is 19.9. Eighth grade, with somewhat smaller numbers, is 17.11. JGMS core average overall is 18.85. So the middle school model, as you remember, is a team-based model, and we have two teams at each grade. So there's going to be some movement within the class sizes when we have a little bit of a smaller grade, but it's not a reason to completely change our model, especially since it's likely to change in the following year. Where we see the pressures at JGMS really are in mostly in our specials. Mm-hmm. And so we have just a few classes under 10, one of them being a core subject, but we have 31 classes at or over 25. Only four of them are core subjects, thank goodness. But you can see in a range of classes that we're really pushing the max, well over the max. And even though these are, you know, the gymnasium, you might think, well, what's the big deal? You can just have lots of kids doing different games. But instruction is very much a part of our PE and health classes. And so those numbers are truly problematic. So we're going to see some pressure there as well. At the high school, our grade 9, these are resident and Boston students, 187, 41 Hanscom students, 199 sophomores from Bedford in Boston, 37 Hanscom, 154 juniors, 29 Hanscom, 174 seniors, 20 for totals of 194, 183, 236, and 228, 841. So that number we expect actually to hold relatively steady next year and then begin to climb on its way to approximately 1,000, 1,050. Class size and average class size overlays, just to remind you, thanks to teachers who are willing to do more than they are required to do, we have many classes at the high school, and actually many more than all the districts that I investigated several years ago, where teachers are teaching multiple courses or multiple levels in the same class. And that's what we call overlays. So, for example, an art class might have, ceramics 2 major, a ceramics 2 minor, an art portfolio 3, and another one all in one class. Or a social studies class might have half level 4 and half level five students. And so there's differential grading, some difference in assignments, et cetera. So that's quite extensive in our district. And that's because we are a relatively small district, and so we can't, the only way we can offer the rich curriculum that we do is to ask more of our teachers and therefore be able to deliver that range of courses. This, I believe, is not core. I think this includes our specials and some of our smaller classes. I'm going to have to come back and check on that with you. But tier one would be, this would be our majors, would be 18 average. And tier two and tier three, which is our support classes, our special ed centers, et cetera, reading courses are around six students per course, which is typical. This goes into where we have lower than 10 or lower. It looks like a lot, but as I'm sure you read through, you saw that there are pretty strong reasons for each of them. So particularly, wanting to be able to offer an AP biology course. We have two sections. One happened to fill at 20. And the only way to get more kids into AP biology would be to offer two sections. Because there are so many constraints on student schedules in a small district like this, we can't offer multiple sections. So sometimes we have to offer a second section which has pretty low numbers, and we're not able to balance them out. That's pretty typically what the reasons are. Here's another one, Advanced Latin. There's two other sections, one at 18, one at 16, but again, it's advanced, so these kids are also taking APs and other subjects like that. We can't just throw these kids into these two classes without them missing out on other things. In terms of the college prep classes that are at or over 18, we have 10 core subjects that are in that situation and four electives. And classes that are at or over 25, which is our honors, high honors, and AP. We have 11 core subjects, six elective majors. So for example, an elective major would be gender studies or economics. It's not an elective in the sense that most kids choose to take 4 years of social studies, but it's not required. So I'm calling it an elective here, but they're pretty much core academic subjects. We have 13 at 25, 10 at 26, 5 at 27, and 1 at 28. You can see that we have a few classes like AP statistics with 26 and calculus. AP calculus. Yeah, so that's within the range. Any questions?
I'll start. So, John, as you put this all together, what jumps out at you the most? What surprised you the most?
I don't think anything surprised me because I've been following the trends. I think that, there are really no surprises. We've seen for the last couple years that our Davis and our Lane have come a little under what our predictions were. But I don't think that's anything to count on in terms of a trend, knowing what's coming and what's going on in the town. So that's not significant. In terms of our pressure points, the only thing I didn't really see coming was that 217, what that impact might have going from a 10 class grade to a 9 class grade. And so there's a challenge there, which I didn't anticipate, but okay. That's about it.
Now, first looking at the first page with enrollment trends, and we look at the preschool numbers, and that's been quite a jump since its inception. So now we're at 51 students. Mm-hmm. And I guess I'm just going to question. We had talked last year about the possibility of at some point adding some ELL students to the preschool, if we could find the funding, if we could. Is there plans to grow it, or are we at capacity in the preschool?
No, first of all, we did add tuition. We did have scholarships for a few students this year. We took that suggestion.
We did?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
Yes, absolutely.
I guess I have to read.
I built it into the budget.
No, I knew we talked about it in the budget. Mm-hmm. It was an add all, but I didn't know that it actually, the funding went through for it. Okay.
Yes, it did. I think it's two or three students. I'll
Fantastic.
Get the number.
Okay.
We do have the capacity to grow because a lot of the students are in half-day programs, and so there's the opportunity to offer other half-days that mirror that, you know, afternoon program opposite the morning programs, mm-hmm. Or to make more of them full day. So there is room to grow there.
And maybe if we are able to add more slots or get more funding, even do a lottery, or I guess I wasn't sure even how we select those kids.
Yeah. That'll be part of my, what I'll
As we
back.
Think about it yeah. going forward. That's mm-hmm. wonderful. Great. And then Lane Davis, we saw the, I guess I want to, Davis School, just because there's a typo on it, on Davis School, emotional is spelled wrong. We can just fix that at some point. Mm-hmm. And I assume at some point we'll get an update from the special ed department later. I'm just curious about the growth in the autism classes compared to last year to this year, and what our numbers look like, how many kids went out, but I believe Marianne will come later in the year and update us on that.
I can tell you how many kids are out now.
We know that because we know the districts, but I'm just curious, looking year to year, are we seeing more involved kids, less involved? It's just interesting to see sort of where the trends are as we plan going forward. Thank you for providing the documentation on the public schools and the private schools. And I believe students are given the option of an exit interview. They don't have to do it, but if students leave, we can find out why they're leaving. Do we track that?
I don't want to misspeak. I'm not sure whether they do it.
One thing I'd be really curious about, although it's a, I don't think people leave because they're bullied, but I just want to make sure that's not the case. If there was any, people go to private school for all sorts of reasons. We just want to make sure that we're not missing anything. And I don't have any reason to suspect we are, but I don't know how we talk to people when they leave.
Well, I think it would be unusual for that to happen without it being on our radar.
And we would know about it.
That the parents were not happy with how we addressed bullying.
Or some parent might just want a smaller school, smaller setting.
No, I'm saying if it's bullying.
Right.
I think we would know about
that. Okay. I'm sorry I brought it up, but I was really curious what would prompt people to leave. And then I have to applaud the district for offering the students so many options of classes at the high school level. It's extraordinary given how small we are. Do we ask teachers for their thoughts on the overlay? Because it can be challenging in a classroom. If you're teaching level 5 French and level 4 in the same room, and it's a lot of work for the teachers, frankly. It's a lot of moving parts. And I guess, is there an opportunity for teachers to give feedback on that? That they still feel this is the way to go, that we can do it, that we have the right people in place? Because I worry sometimes, do you lose anything trying to be everything to everybody? I'm not saying that's the experience at the high school. If anything, most students will tell you they like having the variety, they like having the choices. I just think it's a lot. I don't know how common this is in other towns of our size, and I just worry sometimes that it's a lot of work for the teachers.
It is. I mean, it's clear, and I think I should probably make sure it's clear, always clear to new teachers, that it's not something required of them.
They
want to make sure that they can offer the range of courses, particularly in courses like art and music and things like that. You know, they're committed to that subject matter, and the only way to be able to have kids not end at photography 1, but actually develop is to be able to provide different things.
So, well, I'd also imagine there'd be some benefit to different level language. Some kids who were at the lower level would benefit from having students who are more proficient in the class, right?
It may be. We're actually seeing some of the opposite right now, where kids they're feeling left behind because too many kids are at a different, these are for kids that have taken the on-ramp later on. So that's why it's so important that we're now providing an on-ramp for kids as a group to kind of start in middle school. Because where we haven't, we were just talking about this the other day, some kids are just, they can't converse like the other kids, and so they...
Well, it used to be you went to Latin, right? I mean, that was...
Still
truthfully,
is. Still
it, it's, it was a great, for, especially for kids with learning disabilities, kids with other, it was a mm-hmm. great option, but obviously they want to be able to do more. The only other question I have is with respect to the math class, Algebra 1, Fundamentals, Math 2, and there's a note that there are two singleton students with complicated profiles that are in those classrooms. I'm assuming they're in those classrooms with support. This is at the high school?
Yeah, I'm sure they are.
They're just, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
There's a reason for that, and there's something mm-hmm. going on. Okay. Because yes. That just sort of that left out at me. Great. Thank you.
I guess I had some questions about, maybe some of them answered, about the overlay, because I don't know that I've ever seen that before or heard about it being done. And not sure if there's an answer here or not, but... I kind of find it concerning to have fundamentals and math applications all together in one from a learning perspective, especially for the struggling learner.
Show me where you're looking at that.
I mean, this was on the overlays on the, so this is Algebra 1, Fundamentals of Math 2, Math Applications are all overlaid.
That's the page,
yeah. Yeah. I just bring it up as a potential
sure,
concern.
No, I understand.
Especially for the struggling student. I mean, that's great if a teacher's willing to do that, but I think it could be at the detriment of a student.
Right. My guess is that Algebra 1 is the primary mm-hmm. curriculum,
right.
And that there's one or two kids that we can't have a whole separate course for,
right.
And so that there'll be support in that class for those kids.
Right.
But I'll get the specifics.
Yeah,
on that.
I just wonder about, I mean, sort of their self-esteem and how they're feeling about, you know, potentially being a struggling math student and then surrounded by kids who are more proficient.
Keep in mind, this is not a large range of proficiency, so kids who are taking Algebra 1 in ninth grade mm-hmm. are kids who have also struggled in math up
yeah.
until that point, because the vast majority of kids, and particularly with some new courses that we've created at the middle school to provide algebra even to some struggling students, these are kids that still couldn't get there.
Right.
And so they're really, there's probably not that big a difference between the Algebra 1 kids and the kids with fundamentals.
Right.
But I'm going to get some
But
more
I just wonder if the perception from the child might be different than what it looks like to the
True.
Teacher.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And overlay, I think, you know, between like photo 1 and photo 2, that seems to blend more easily, and I can see that. But overlay mm-hmm. when you know, things like this seem a little bit more complex. And then wondering about that second grade class that has 10 classes now and will go to 9. How do we address that going forward, or what are the possible solutions to that?
I think that the average would be 24 kids per class, and one would be 25. If there's any move-ins after that, we could have a few classes at 25. So that's, you know, that is at the high range. It's
mm-hmm.
still within our range. It's just not optimum.
Yeah.
So it'll be discussed as a budget possibility, mm-hmm. you know, whether we can support a 10th third-grade teacher.
Right.
And that'll have to line up against other budget priorities.
And is there the space in the building for them to be able to do that? Do we know?
Yes, but they'll have to do a little bit of moving around to make it happen.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
There are three of us who have rising third graders in that class.
So.
Oh, I remember those days.
So we, the three, one, two, three of us have kids in that class, so we'll be watching that. I'm wondering about lunch. How is lunch doing? Is it tight? Is there, I know lunch is, the time is short, so to make another lunch would be crazy. I think kids would be eating at 10 in the morning. But is that a worry because of the numbers?
Davis or Lane?
I guess any of them, because any of them, because Davis Lane and JGMS have like the rotating lunch.
Yeah. So Davis, because of the added space, lunch is actually better, and they can move kids through faster, so kids can get more time to eat. So there's no interest, there's really no interest in either of the elementary schools.
Okay.
I think lunch across the board is in decent shape.
Okay. And then you talked about specials in JGMS and that sort of, they're busting at the seams. How about Davis and Lane? Are they, how are they doing with the specials? I mean, we're adding another, we've been adding classroom teachers, but this, and now they're two PE teachers, which, but they're also two PE classes per class a week. How are art and music doing? Are they feeling the crunch? I mean, I think it feels like their time is just getting shorter and shorter that they see the kids because they have to rotate them all through. But how is that?
So over the last 5 years, as Davis jumped, you know, that initial 50 kids and then began to grow beyond that, starting in 2012, we did add in some of the specials areas, like we only had one PE teacher for the longest time. So kind of, we've already been making those adjustments. Beth has been pretty clear that if we were to have to add an additional class at any of the grades, it would trigger the need not only for another classroom teacher, but for more specials. And then, you know, and we built with that in mind, right, just in case of that possibility, so that there would be room to add some art and some music. But right now, and given our predictions of where the numbers are going, we'll be fine.
Okay. Great, and then, yeah, again, once again, the second to third, I'm curious about solutions for that. Thank you.
At the high school in particular, how much of this is a scheduling issue versus a space issue with the large classes?
Scheduling almost entirely.
Okay, so the space is fine, just the logistics of the classes and the options and the overlays make the classes larger. That's what I thought the answer was. Just a note, which I found interesting, kindergarten, plus 23 boys to girls. First grade, plus 36 boys to girls. It feels like a boy-heavy K-1, it is. And second grade is plus 29 girls to boys. So prom in
the prom's gonna be
2035 or so. It's going to require some creative thinking for guys that want to take girls.
And who knows?
Apropos
who knows how those match up?
Yeah, amazing. So anyway. I remember the first time I saw these, we approved the guideline and the maximum, and we were so high on all of them. And we said, with the additions, they'll come down. And they have, so kudos to you, to the town for supporting new FTEs. Like, some of these are a little high. They were a lot higher in recent history. So I'm actually encouraged by how close we are, how we are within the guidelines. Even if we go up in the third grade next year, you know, I feel like 4 years ago these numbers were all above in every grade. So credit to our planning and John,
thank
to your
you.
Foresight in getting us there. I really enjoyed the JGMS net numbers. I recall that last year we had 21 new I counted 29 new on a level, MACA level. I'm curious about just in the district, what is the ins and outs and the inflows and outflows each year and how that trends. I assume it's trending up like this and we're gaining kids each year that we don't expect that aren't born here. Along those lines, I think it would be helpful from a demographic perspective and comparing a birth perspective, which we do, to separate out the Boston and Bedford numbers in the Bedford category to see of the kids who were born here, how many are here, as best we can gauge. And I, ignorant of this question, I should know the answer.
So I'm just curious, why would we want that? Just to know?
Because we say the number of kids born in Bedford is a predictor of Bedford enrollment. So you can't include Boston in the Bedford numbers because those aren't Bedford-born kids for our projections. And that's just one. I just don't know the procedure of how do we set a number for Boston.
So
do we accept? Is it a contract? Do they apply? Do we get sent? I don't know the answer. You know.
So that's actually set. I had to learn that's actually set through the Metco contract overall,
okay.
Because. Money comes with each child.
Right.
And so if we were to increase without consulting the other districts, mm-hmm. we would actually be taking potential a share of the money mm-hmm. beyond. So we're at approximately 100.
Right.
And unless there's some significant change in the funding, that won't change in the future.
So we can reasonably expect a number
yes.
of X per Hanscom right. and of Boston yeah. plus Bedford kids. So that's why I would like to see that.
But Hanscom changes all the time.
Hanscom changes.
We don't know if there's
But it's
more.
Always around. I mean, certainly here, I asked the question before, it trends down over the course of the high school, but now how many is it per year? Just help us project, accurately for the future. Yeah. I'd like to see those separated out.
Sure, we can do that.
But again, I recall these numbers being a lot scarier in recent history, so I'm thankful for the report and the detail, and I feel generally very good about it, so thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
I will echo Dan's last comment. Kudos to you and the leadership team and the people who are no longer in the district who worked on getting those numbers down. I had a couple of questions. The first is, so Davis, we know, should be fine because they just finished. And I know the middle school can go up, Kevin thought, to 700 students.
Right.
And
if beyond 700, it could trigger the need
yeah.
for another team.
So we're at about 600 now, so we have some space there. The high school you just said is fine. How close to capacity is the Lane School now?
Mm-hmm. In terms of space, mm-hmm. it's very close, right?
Okay.
And again, we would have to... we'd have to do some internal modifications and some moving around if mm-hmm. we did add another classroom.
Okay, so mm-hmm. so we're using all of the classrooms that were constructed and created a few years ago. So we would have to go back to a situation where things are moved around and suboptimal if we have to increase more than one additional class.
Yes.
Okay. So the increase in the number of preschoolers, did that increase because there were children who had to be educated, or did that increase because we had space?
Because they were kids that needed to be educated.
Okay. All right, but that because there are so many preschoolers who are in other situations, that does not necessarily mean that we will see a commensurate increase in the number of kindergartners when those kids move into kindergarten.
No.
It just means they're identified early.
Yeah, but it does not indicate that, a 20% increase in preschool numbers will mean a 20% increase
no.
in kindergartners.
I don't believe so.
It just means kids are being identified earlier with disabilities.
Okay.
And the what are called typical non-special mm-hmm. ed students, I think non-special ed is a better term, they would very likely be at some other preschool.
Yeah.
Right? But they're here. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that changes the numbers. What we are a little surprised by, back to Ann's question, is that When we went to five-day kindergarten, we thought that the change from kindergarten to first grade would disappear. And there's still some change from kindergarten to first grade, so we still must be getting some kids from private kindergartens, like Montessori.
Well, you're getting the birthday kids, too.
Yeah, and the birthday kids.
Because a lot of parents are registering their kids and putting them somewhere else for a year. Is that the right term? But I think that's what they're doing.
Okay.
They're coming in at 10. No, I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah, I have no other questions. So is the vote on this the class maximums?
To approve the report.
To approve the report, okay. Do I hear a motion to approve the, sorry, I'm just looking for the title, the 2020 to 21 class size report? I'm sorry, 2019 to 2020 class size report?
So moved.
Second. Ms. Brascal moves, Ms. Scoville seconds. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. Any abstentions? That's approved 5-0-0. Thank you. And I'm sorry, I just lost my place. The next item on the agenda is the student self-injury and suicidal ideation protocols and resources.
Right. Mr. So I'm not going to make a presentation. I'm inviting Alicia to come.
Thank you. Great.
And I just wanted to give you a heads up ahead of time. And also, if anything jumped out at this point that you'd like me to prepare her to have questions around, feel free to share them. If not, certainly you can send them to me, and she'll come in the next month probably to respond.
Okay. Super. Any questions, comments on the materials that we had to read?
No, I think it's great.
Okay. Thank you. So the next item is the superintendent's report, Mr. Sells.
Okay. So, you've also inquired about what Challenge Success is work is this year. And again, Heather has offered to come back and do a presentation. But I thought I would highlight a few things just to make it clear that some great work is going on. So I think that, first of all, the high school, and with some help from the middle school, has been sponsoring and will continue to sponsor a speaker series around parenting and child raising and school issues regarding stress. Apparently there was about a 300 person turnout at the first one.
That's incredible. Yeah.
Which is really great. And a lot of the parents were K through 8, not high school. A large number of elementary parents were there. Really interested.
I was glad to see there.
It was Michael Thompson who was talking at that speaker series, and there'll be a few more.
There's a big push in the elementary newsletters and stuff, right, which was great, which I haven't seen as much of before for other sort of high school-centered, middle school-centered events. So I think that made a big difference.
That's great.
Yeah.
The high school is piloting advisory in ninth grade, and advisory, just as we have it in the middle school, is an opportunity for adults to build relationships with kids that they don't necessarily see in class, and to increase the number of adults to whom students can go or with whom students feel comfortable, sharing concerns, being referred to specialists if need be. And there'll be some curriculum. There is some curriculum associated with that, around things like signs of suicide, and that'll be a place to deliver some of that. Creation of a Challenge Success webpage. The student-run group, which is called Ground Up, is reading a book together, Where You Go Is Not Who You'll Be, and they're going to do a presentation to parents from that material. There's a committee exploring Q5, which is the fifth quarter idea that some districts like Concord-Carlisle do, will make recommendations. Piloting mental health days for students, that's still something to be worked out. And there's a faculty-wide book study on overloaded and underprepared. So There's several other things, but I'll wait for Heather to do that. But I just wanted to make sure that you and the public knew that that work is moving forward very deliberately and with a great deal of energy. And I'm sorry to say that we are seeing the signs of stress. It's amazing. I mean, I talk to colleagues. It is a phenomenon all over. The number of children who are really, really, really struggling. And the impact that that's having on our staff, in terms of needing to and wanting to be there for kids, and concerns about averting future tragedies, is a very real part, particularly at the secondary level, but not exclusively so. We've talked about before, and as was reminded by Tessier's slides, we do have cameras now on the exterior of the high school and JGMS, and the plan is to have them in all four schools. And we have not been a camera happy school. You have not been a camera happy school committee. I have not been a camera happy superintendent, and I've been against having internal cameras based on privacy concerns and kind of big picture concerns about people giving up privacy for security, understanding that there are some real needs there. So the rationale for exterior cameras was really to protect our property from vandalism, also to protect our children from dangerous activities, because we have kids climbing up on the roofs to do various things over the years. And so I feel fine about doing that. But inevitably, what's come up is now that we have the cameras, there are outside activities during the school day that are caught on camera. And so we really have to have a policy about whether to use cameras to investigate certain things, and if so, how and for what kinds of things. The reality is there are real dangerous things that happen during the school day outside in the least supervised times. That's often where bullying takes place, because it's impossible to have teachers' eyes on every single kid. That's where, unfortunately, when there's been some racist comments, that's sometimes when they happen. And so there's certainly a strong rationale for doing it, so we can both deter and get to the bottom of those things in a way that doesn't completely eat up hours and hours of time of our, sometimes unsuccessfully. So I think that it's worthy of debate whether to have some allow uses of the cameras for outside activities during school time in certain instances. And with the help of the principals who are really pushing for this, I'll come forward with a proposed policy so that there's something concrete to discuss, to either modify or to accept or to reject. I think that's the best way to have the discussion. So I'll come forward with that in a couple of weeks. But
and you'll talk to the police as well, get their input?
Oh, yeah.
Because that's where it gets really colorful.
Yes. So I wanted to get that on the table. You may have been following that that there's a bill in the state legislature about the foundation budget, and it's very exciting. I'm not sure how it's going to end up. I'm getting a head shake from Ann.
It's so ambitious. It has to be done. I worry what it's going to do to districts like us.
Yeah. So we would benefit very little compared to rural districts and urban districts. Where we could benefit a lot is if the transportation
for special ed
is finally included as it's intended to be and is passed. There are also some factoring in the foundation budget process that we could also benefit from, I believe, which is how in-house special education, students who receive in-house special education services are credited in the calculation, that so may go up from 3.75 to 4%, and I'm not sure exactly how that works. I'll be asking Julie to help to explain that later.
See, what makes no sense to me is why you didn't put it in Circuit Breaker. You could roll transportation right through Circuit Breaker. It'd be much easier to budget.
It will.
That's what they're talking about.
That is the plan.
They're not going to put it through the foundation budget. They're going to add it to Circuit Breaker.
Yes.
Good. So we've been asking for that for years.
Yes.
So that would be part of that line item for Circuit Breaker.
Yeah. What I'm talking about is how we count
in-house
students who are in-house served for special education.
Which would not be part, and they're going to add that to Circuit Breaker?
No, that's how they calculate the foundation budget. And it looks like that's going to go up incrementally, but since we have so many kids served in-house, there could be some benefits there.
That makes a conflict. Well, okay. If it's the right place for the kids, right?
Mm-hmm. It's always if it's the right place. Yeah. I mean, we don't do it for the
No. Not every district is better. I'm just saying, when you start incentivizing it to folks,
it's not. Good. I mean, it's a per person minute change.
It's not enough.
It's not,
okay.
Right.
So you're supportive of it, even though it may, because in those instances it would be very helpful for the district.
I think so. Yeah.
Great.
So I think as we get a little better handle on it and see where it's moving, we will try to present a little more understanding of how the foundation budget actually is built. I think you may or may not all understand that fully, but I think there's real value in seeing what the various factors are that are calculated in the foundation budget.
Could we roll the military into that?
Well, I believe they count. That's something that...
Well, they count, but I'm just saying, like, how we get our money every year for Hanscom, how Bourne gets their money. Is there a way to just put it in the foundation budget?
You mean so it would be less prone to appropriation?
Hmm. Worth exploring. I mean, if we're going to cover... If we're trying to level the playing field, make it better for all students, figure out where districts aren't getting their needs met, transportation's great on special ed, raising your... But that might be a nice way to write in that section to cover the military families.
Speaking of which, Congressman Moulton's office has asked for documentation regarding impact aid and the history, and they want to try to do something. So a big binder was sent off to them.
Wonderful.
With that data. Thank you.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is meeting minutes. We have two sets of minutes to review, and we'll take comments and edits one at a time. We'll start with the September 10th, 2019 meeting minutes. Okay. Any comments or changes, Ms. Guay?
Yes, I just have two minor changes. On page 1, line 30, classroom, I believe it's just OT space and take out the P. Or it could be OTPT. Sorry, now that makes even more sense.
Yeah.
So it's OT / PT.
Nice call, Mom.
And then on page 7, line 36, particularities to trauma-sensitive classrooms, I would just say that will be considered. We'll just look at them. That's what we're going to do. Just a little more clear. But other than that, no changes. Thank you.
I have the same one, OTPT.
Okay.
Thank you.
We've spent a lot of time in those offices.
Tell them why.
I have nothing. What do you have?
I want to compliment our new
nice work
minutes writer. They're thorough, they're excellent. I enjoy them. Currently, I have no edits.
Wow. And I cried.
That's impressive.
And I have no edits either. Thank you very much. So do I hear a motion to approve the meeting minutes of September 10th, 2019?
So moved.
So moved. Mr. Barascal moves, Ms. Boyer seconds. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And all opposed say no. Any abstentions? That's approved 5-0-0. The second set of minutes is September 24th. Comments or edits? Ms. Gui?
I did not have any edits on these.
Okay. Ms. Gui?
No, thank you.
Ms. Vogel? No?
Nope.
Mr. Brasco?
I have the same comment as Nate. Great.
Okay, and none for me either. Congratulations.
You're taking away all the fun from the committee.
Wow.
Is that a record?
So, thank you very much. Do I hear a motion to approve the minutes of September 24th, 2019?
So moved.
Ms. Scoville moves.
Second.
Ms. Markey seconds. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Any abstentions? That's approved 5-0-0. And are there any future agenda items that anybody has?
I don't know if this is an agenda item, but it's a question to look at. Is Labor Day next year is really late? It's like the 8th of... I've already gotten questions from the community.
I am really impressed with those moms.
Yes, they're organized. They want to preserve their Cape House in August. And are wondering whether
I think
we'll
need to have a discussion of the start date for next year because it really is late. And once before when it was really
It happened
late,
a couple years ago, we moved it before.
We did move it, so I've been thinking about that as well. Great. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. And I think I mentioned at a previous time, maybe a presentation about EDCO Lab, same.
Yes, I've been inviting them, and I'm just trying to get dates for each of them to come and present.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Speaking of, just if I may, real quickly, speaking of holidays, we've had some inquiries about Columbus Day, and that there are places that are changing the name to Indigenous Peoples Day. In fact, all of Maine, all of Vermont, I think, some states have done that. At the moment, I've shared that I think it needs to be a town issue, not just a school issue. Or a state issue, not just a Bedford issue, but I think that how we address the issues around Columbus Day are really important for our curriculum. And so I've been gathering data to share back about that, and it's an important issue.
Great. Any others? Okay, I have one. Mike Rosenberg is, I think, chairing the Bedford 300th Anniversary Committee, and he has extended an invitation to the school committee to have a liaison on that committee. It's going to be an evening once a month. If anybody's interested, please let me know. And
what is the 300th?
The 300th anniversary of Bedford?
No, what's the date?
Oh, what's the date?
When is it?
Year or the year?
1729
to 2029.
I'm on that committee.
Some serious long-range plans.
We're looking 9 years out.
Once a month for the next 8 years, 10 years.
It's like playing the program. Wow. I'm going to hold off on that. That's amazing. I hope it's blocked
by. All right. Do I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting at 9:13?
So moved.
Mr. Brasco moves, Ms. Gui seconds with gusto. This requires a roll call vote. Ms. Gui?
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Scoville? Ms. Brasco?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much, and good night, Bedford.